See?
I love it. Buddy's just unashamed. The best way to spread Christmas cheer is singing loud for all to hear. So he's just going to do it, even if he's alone in a department store. And I think there's something that we all can learn from Buddy the Elf this morning. And it's not to sing loud in a department store. Please don't hear that. Like, don't walk out of here and go to Yonkers and sing the carols at the top of your lungs. Say, my pastor revision said to. I did not. I will disown you. But, like, understand, like, there's something we can glean from Buddy. What I think that we can learn from this character, Buddy the Elf, is this, like, Buddy realizes that part of Christmas, like a really important part of Christmas, isn't just experiencing it, it's embodying it. Like, at some point along the line in Buddy's life, he got the idea that it's his personal responsibility to bring Christmas to the world. And what if we thought about Christmas like that? Let me explain what I mean. We're finishing off this Socks and Undies series today. For the last month, we've been digging into the Christmas story as it's told in the Gospel of John. And kind of looking at the ways during the Christmas season in which we marginalize Jesus. The ways we make little of this incredible gift of God coming down to earth to be with us. We've been talking about the way that at Christmas, so often instead of treating Jesus like the greatest gift the world has ever known, we kind of treat Jesus like unwrapping socks or undies at Christmas. We just don't get that excited about it. We treat it like this gift that, like, oh, we know maybe we could use, but it isn't the gift that we most wanted and the gift that we really expected. And so we just kind of marginalize Christ. And last week we talked about what it looks like to open up that gift. What it looks like to just receive that gift. And I want to share some news with you guys this morning. Like, last week we had three people open that gift for the first time here at Revision. And this month, we've had four people say that they opened that gift for the first time. That they didn't want to treat Jesus like socks and undies anymore. They didn't want to just put him in the corner and let that gift get dusted. They want to open it up and realize all that it means for them, that God came to reconcile them to himself. And I don't know about you, but that fires me up. And that's why we're here. Four people, that's four eternities changed. And heaven, or the Bible tells us that heaven has a party every time that happens. So here's what I want to do right now. I just want to give a standing ovation for the fact that four people, four eternities, four stories, four futures changed this month at Every Vision. Like, let's stand up and clap for those people right now. You guys can take a seat. But here's, man, that fires me up. Like, that's what Revision is here for, to help people meet Jesus and follow him fully. And some of you in this room this morning opened that gift for the first time last week. And here's what I want to say to you, and here's what I want to say to all of us who opened it a long time ago, who received Christ into our lives, who would claim Jesus for our own. That receiving Christ, receiving this incredible gift of the creator of the universe come down for us is not the end of our Christmas story. If we just unwrap it and then we stop, we miss out on the fullness of what that gift means in our lives and the fullness of what that gift ought to mean for our world. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, you can crack them open to John chapter 1. We've been reading through the odd Christmas story as it's told in the first chapter of John. John's the fourth book of the New Testament, sandwiched right between Luke and Acts. If you don't have the Bible, don't worry, the words are going to be on the screen. But this is the way that John kicks off his Christmas story. He kicks it off at the very beginning of the world. In verses 1 through 5, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Let me jump down to verse 14 in John chapter 1. And John tells us that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And in John 12, he said, "To all who would receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." I want to do this morning, as we close out this series, as we close out our look at the Christmas story in the Gospel of John, is look at the last two verses that John writes about the Christmas story in chapter 1. Or the last three. In verses 16 through 18 of John chapter 1, John writes this: "Out of his fullness, we have all received grace in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. We received grace in place of grace already given. Grace and truth came to the world, came to us through Jesus Christ. And though no one's ever seen God, Christ came and embodied him and he revealed God to us. And this is a big idea. This is the heartbeat of Christmas. And I think it's summed up really well in one of my favorite Christmas carols. It's one that probably most of us have sung more times than we can count. It's an old one by John Wesley called Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And there's this verse that we've sung countless times in Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Peace on earth. Isn't that a beautiful thought? Mercy mild. I have no idea what that means. I never have. It rhymes with reconciled, I guess. I'm sure it's a beautiful thought. It was when Wesley wrote it. There's so many songs we sing in church and hymns that we don't understand what they mean. I don't know what mercy mild means, but God and sinners reconciled. God and sinners reconciled. This is the heart of the Christmas message. What about sinners and sinners reconciled? What if part of this Christmas narrative isn't just that we received grace in place of grace already given, that we experienced and understood God as Christ revealed him to us, but that we are, because of that, because of the gift that we've received, because of the grace that we've received, because of the reconciliation to God that we've received, we are supposed to go and extend that grace to the world around us. What if part of the Christmas message that's just as important as God reconciling us to himself is God sending us out to reconcile the world to himself and to reconcile sinners to sinners? Reconciliation is one of those words that's it's six syllables long and it feels like it should be. Because the concept that reconciliation describes is long and it's painful and it's frustrating. Reconciliation isn't comfortable, and it certainly isn't natural, but it's necessary. So what I want us to understand this Christmas season is that, reconciliation is necessary. It's necessary for us. So we don't carry the same baggage around to relationship after relationship after relationship, and then wonder what's wrong with every other person on the planet. Reconciliation is necessary for others, for those people whom we have a relationship with, that we've been cut off from, that are hurt and they're broken and they don't see a way forward and they're waiting for us to make the first move. Reconciliation is necessary for the sake of our conscience so that we don't have to squash it down and kill it and pretend that it isn't ringing in our ears every time it says that we should make amends, that we should reach out to the people that we've hurt or the people that have hurt us. And most importantly, for those of us who would embrace Christ, for those of us who would say that the Christmas story is our story, that this gift of God giving himself to the world is a gift that we've received, for those of us who would claim Christ, reconciliation is necessary for Christ's sake. Part of what Christmas means is embodying reconciliation and extending grace to our world. But if you're like me, that's hard. It's a hard one to wrap our minds around. It's super easy during Christmas to get really excited about what God did for me. Because I'm selfish. I get fired up about that. I sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Peace on Earth, Mercy Mild, God and sinners reconciled. I get all these warm, fuzzy feelings about God, the God of the universe, coming down to get into right relationship with me. That he did that for me. And I'm just blown away by that gift. It's the most incredible gift the world's ever received. I'm blown away by it. And I love it that God did that for me. But then you start talking about sinner and sinner reconciled. That one who hurt me, that one who wronged me, and me getting reconciled. Time out. I don't like that as much. I don't like that as much. It'd be a nice concept, right? I can envision what it might be like to have every broken relationship in my life restored, but I could give you 20 reasons right now why I don't want to make that phone call. I'm not going to make a list for you of reasons right now why I don't want to put in the work to make that happen, why it's not important for me to do. But check it out. God had an endless list of reasons not to reconcile with us. I'm pretty sure God had an endless list of reasons why he shouldn't have reconciled with us. An endless list of reasons why he didn't have to empty himself out so that out of his fullness we could receive grace on top of grace. And I think that list is probably longer for me or for people like me. Like for those of us who grew up in church. Like I grew up in church, we were the people who were like, we were never the first people there. Our family's late. Yesterday we were supposed to take family pictures and we all showed up a half an hour late. I felt bad for the photographer, but like we were never the first people there, but we were always the last people there. We were in church 8 days a week. And so I started thinking about Jesus and like the list of reasons he could come up with to not reconcile with people. I think for me, that's probably a long list. Because I knew that what I was doing was wrong. Like some of you had to become adults before you got to church and realized your sins. But I don't know. I can tell you the verse in the Bible for the sins that I was committing. Like I didn't just know that the Bible said I shouldn't do stuff. I knew where the Bible said I shouldn't do the dumb stuff that I just did. So I think like God's making a list of people that he shouldn't reconcile, of reasons not to reconcile. Like I'm on that list, and the reasons are many. The reasons are many. But at Christmas, I sing peace on earth, mercy on earth, God and sinners reconciled, because I believe that I am one of those sinners that's been reconciled. I believe it. And I approach God with that belief. We all do. You may have never thought about this before. You may never have realized it before. But I'm willing to bet that you approach God with this confidence, this assurance that you are reconciled to him. Every time we pray, every time we sin and ask for forgiveness, every time we petition God and ask him for something, we're banking on, we are counting on the fact that he meant it when he said he came to reconcile us to him. We're counting on it, because if he didn't, like, what does that mean? If he didn't, then we got to approach God in this entirely different way. But I understand, too, like, when God reconciled himself to me, when God did that, it cost him more than it would cost me to do it. It cost him more. It cost him more than a little time spent writing a letter. It cost him more than a 49-cent stamp. It required more of him than a visit or a call or an awkward conversation. Like the Word, the creator of all things, became flesh and made his dwelling among us. He was born in a barn to an impoverished family, and then ultimately he was nailed to a tree. For me, it cost him everything. But I think if we're truthful with ourselves, if we're truthful with each other this morning, when it comes to sinners, to us being reconciled with people that we've broken relationships with people who have hurt us or have wronged us, when it comes to that, like it's just so easy to come to the place where we refuse to engage that reconciliation, where we make a ton of excuses about why we can't do it or why we shouldn't do it or why we don't want to do it, or we just avoid it because we don't want to pay the cost. We get to the point where we realize what it's going to take for us to reach out. What it's gonna take for us to embody Christ in that relationship. And we know what it's gonna cost us on a personal level, on a relational level, and on an emotional level. We just don't wanna pay that cost. We just think, man, that cost is too much. And so we say, no, it's impossible. It's not possible, it's just too weird. It's just too awkward, it's just too far gone. It costs too much. I don't know if it's worth it. But what's the reality of Christmas? Like John tells us that Christmas is the Word becoming flesh and making his dwelling among us. The Word becoming flesh and making his dwelling among us. And in his letter to the church at Philippi, Paul expounds upon that a little bit. He says, man, if that doesn't floor you enough, check it out. This is what that looked like. And he writes this, Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And Jesus did it in order that we could receive grace. He made himself nothing. He emptied himself out. He poured himself out for us so that we could receive this life-changing, world-shattering, undeserved grace. And Paul writes to the church at Corinth, and he expounds upon that grace, and he says this, for God was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in him. That through him, this is Jesus, to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your mind because of your evil behavior, but now he's reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. I love this picture that Paul paints. of us being alienated from God, because I think that all of us in this room, at least on some level, can resonate with that feeling. That feeling of being cut off, of being abandoned, of being left out, of being alienated. And Paul's looking at us and saying, hey, have you ever felt like that? If you've ever felt alienated and cut off, you're not crazy. You were. You were. Every single one of you were alienated. You were cut off from God. But for those of us who have accepted Christ, he did something there. He brought us back to the relationship with the Creator that we were created for. He reconciled us. What I think is so phenomenal about that is that, like, most of us in this room, I mean, those of us who accepted Christ when we were kids, we didn't do it because we felt alienated. Like, we didn't come to the point of accepting Jesus and beginning to follow him because we sensed at the age of six this deep existential angst. We did it because hell sounded scary, right? And so it was like, hey, you need to pray to ask Jesus into your heart. And we're like, all right, I don't know what the hell. Jesus, come into my heart. I don't know how he wants to live in my vital organs. We didn't fully understand it, right? I didn't when I was a kid, but I thought, all right, I'm going to do that. And as I've grown, and as I've understood it, and as I've seen the brokenness of the world, and for those of you maybe who came to faith later in life, we get to this point where we understand just what it means. That we were hopeless and cut off, and God stepped into our story to bridge that gap that we couldn't bridge. That he came to reconcile us, that he created us for relationship with him. And we count on that. We come to the point that we just function in faith and in life under the assumption that God did that for us. I said it, like most of us, we don't even realize it. We don't even think about the fact that we did it. We don't even realize that that's how we approach God all the time. We do. We don't pray worried that God's going to look at us and say, oh no, you didn't. You're going to come to me? Like, after what you did to me. Remember that time in third grade when you lied? I do. Liar. I'm not listening to you today. We pray with this confidence that God's not going to be like, you were speeding yesterday. Don't you come to me and talk to me. Don't you ask me for anything, you speeder. Like, we come to God and we're like, God, I need this. And we trust that he meant it when he said that we're reconciled. We operate under that idea. And this is what we got to see. Like, God comes and says, hey, are we good? We're like, yeah. God, I think so. I hope so. I'm good with you. If you're good with me, thank you. But then God asks us, are you good with her? And what we want to say to God when he asks us that question so much of the time is, oh, that doesn't matter. I'm good with you. So it doesn't matter. It's about my personal relationship with you. It's all that other stuff is extra. I'm like, God, I'm right this way. I don't have to be right this way with everybody else because I'm just trying to be good with you right now. I'm not too worried about the other people stuff. That's like an extra step. But there's no way around it. Like, Jesus makes it clear. It's not possible to be good vertically in your relationship with God if you are not good or you don't care about being good horizontally in your relationships with all the people around you. It is in other religions. Like, if you want to jump out of Christianity and follow some faith where you try and earn your way to heaven, first of all, good luck. You're going to fail. But you can go ahead and do it. Because in other religions, maybe it's okay to, like, do stuff for God and get right here, and then you get bonus points for anything you do for everybody else around you. But that ain't the way Christianity works. It's just not the picture that Jesus painted of what he came for and what he was all about, of what Christmas is all about. See, Jesus paints this picture over and over and over again that he is about making all things right and setting all things right and making all things new. That he came not just to reconcile sinners to God, but to reconcile sinners to sinners. To heal up all of our broken relationships. And he's looking at us and he's saying, I know it's hard. I know it's difficult. I know that right now there's a relationship in your mind. You're thinking, I don't see a way back. I don't see a way that can be reconnected. And Jesus says, I know that it's hard, but you've got to understand those people around you. I love them like I love you. I love them like I love you. And all of us, what we want to do is look at our particular situation and say, yeah, but it's different. And Jesus is saying, that's not that different. It's not that different. Like, whatever broken relationship you have in your life, it's not that different from how broken and how far cut off you were from me. It's not that different. Reconciling broken relationships is the big idea of Christmas. And it's not just about that relationship that your sin cut you off from with God. It's also about the relationships that your sin and the sin of other people cut you off from with them. And what I want us to see is that the gift of Christmas, all that it means, that the creator of the universe, like, invaded history, that he stepped into the darkness and just exploded light into our broken world. All that it means, that gift is wasted and it's missed and it's misused if it's only for you. I think at Christmas, it's easy to get pumped up about God and sinners being reconciled, but at the same time feeling very hesitant when it comes to sinners and sinners being reconciled. But here's the big idea this morning. This is my heartbeat. This is my prayer for a Vision Church. This is my hope that this month of talking about how we can just not marginalize Jesus, not become so familiar with him, that it doesn't blow our minds. That this month where we've tried to recapture this sense of awe and wonder at Christmas, my heart and my prayer. And the big idea this morning is this, like, my hope is that we'll go out and understand that we need to demonstrate what we celebrate at Christmas. We need to demonstrate what we celebrate at Christmas. Like, a few days from now, we're all going to be celebrating Christmas. And we'll all celebrate in different ways with different traditions, but there's probably a lot of overlap. And chances are that all of us on Christmas, in some way, shape, or form, will be giving and receiving and unwrapping presents. Right? We'll be getting gifts. As you're a parent like me of small children, part of that process of getting and receiving gifts is like beating it into your kid's head. Like, this isn't what it's all about. This isn't what it's all about. Like, before you open presents, you're going to make them read Luke 2, and they're going to be, like, not listening. But you do it anyway, because it's important. You're like, all right, we're going to read the Christmas story, and they just want to see what Santa gave them. But you're beating it into your head, like, no, you got to get it. This season is not just about reindeer and elves and a fat creeper who watches you all the time and breaks into your house and then, like, eats all your cookies and leaves you some stuff. Seriously, this is... I wasn't creeped out by Santa as a kid, but the more I tell it to my kids, the weirder I think this cultural thing that we've done is. I get why kids scream their faces off when you try and make them take a picture with Santa. It's just a weird thing. It's behavior modification. As parents, we take anything we can get to make our kids be good. So if you tell them you can get coal or presents, be good. Like, we're gonna take it. But Santa, like, we want to make sure that they know, like, this whole Santa thing, this is not the heart of Christmas. Jesus is the reason for the season. Christmas is about God coming down to earth for us, and he stepped out of eternity into history to light up the darkness of our world and to bring people back into relationship with him. That's what it's all about. I'm going to beat that into my kids' heads until they roll their eyes at me on Christmas. Because it's important for them to know it. What's the meaning of Christmas? But I want to challenge us this morning. The full meaning of Christmas isn't just that Jesus came for us. It's that Jesus came so we could be right with each other. The full meaning of Christmas is that we have the opportunity to do this Christmas for others what God did for us at Christmas 2,000 years ago. We have the opportunity this Christmas to do for others what God did for us at Christmas 2,000 years ago. We have the chance to demonstrate what we celebrate. To live out this thing that we call the incarnation. That Jesus became incarnate in flesh. That God became a man so that he could show who God was to us. And we have the chance to become Jesus to our world. To go out and live it and exemplify it and talk about who Christ is to the people around us. But to do that, we got to embrace. We have to embrace because there is no other way. We have to embrace the grand mission of Jesus, which is to reconcile people to right relationship with God and with one another, to set all things right and make all things new. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinner reconciled. So that, in order that, sinner and sinner might also be reconciled. And this Christmas, walking out and demonstrating what we're celebrating is a more excellent way. So I got a challenge for us. My challenge to us this week, this month, this season, as Christmas is rapidly approaching, I challenge us to no longer be content with the idea that Christmas is just about us, or to be content with the idea that Jesus came just to get us right with God, and not to set all things right, make all things new, and reconcile us to the people around us. I challenge us to no longer believe that we can be okay vertically in our relationship with God if we're not taking active steps to be okay in our relationships with the people around us. Like, let's not be content any longer to keep the outrageous, mind-blowing, incredible gift like this first and greatest ever Christmas gift, Jesus coming into the world. Let's not be content any longer to keep that to ourselves, but instead start living it out in our world. Like, I challenge you, and I pray from the bottom of my heart that you'll do it, that I'll do it. I challenge you to write that letter that maybe you've been thinking about writing for a long time. Maybe you've started a few times and you've never finished because you just can't bring yourself to take that first step of reconciliation. I challenge you to make the first move. I challenge you to extend that invitation to somebody this holiday season that maybe you feel like you should make, but you don't want it. You just don't want it. I challenge you to buy and send that gift that's unexpected, that would just absolutely blow the mind of whoever receives it. I challenge you to mail that card that you've been meaning to mail, but haven't for years and years and years, because you know, if you do, once you take that step, there's some junk for you. There's an awkward, weird conversation coming. You just don't want to have it. You just feel like it costs too much. I challenge you to stop making excuses. And I know they're popping up in your head right now. Even as I'm talking, they're popping up in your head. All the reasons why it's hard to reconcile. And what you want to say to me, what you want to say is, Mike, it's different. Mike, you don't understand. You don't understand my situation. So like, Mike, they don't care. They don't care. You're probably right. You're saying, Mike, they won't appreciate it. They'll never appreciate it. So I can't do it because they won't appreciate it. You're probably right. So Mike, they'll never understand the cost. They're never going to know what it cost me and what it took for me to get to that point where I took the first step. They'll never understand that. You're probably right. Or man, they'll never reciprocate. That gift's never going to be returned. It's worthless because they'll never reciprocate it. You're probably right. Neither did you. Neither did you. Like, take a step back and look at what Jesus did for you. Was it because you really cared? Was it because you understood? Was it because you grasped the fullness of what it was going to cost him to do it for you? Was it because you could reciprocate because there was something that Jesus wanted out of you? Was God's offer to you conditional based on your performance? Or was it just what Jesus did because it's who Jesus is and it's what God's about in the world? I think the biggest hurdle, I know it is for me, and I'm guessing it's true for every single one of us in this room. The biggest hurdle that we have to embracing the fullness of what Christmas means, to living it out and not just receiving it for ourselves, is our pride. Our pride gets in the way. It's our greatest single obstacle, our sense of self-importance and our instinct towards self-preservation. Like, even if we're convinced that it's critically important to demonstrate what we celebrate, even if we know on an intellectual level that Christmas is more than just God reconciling us to himself, it's about God invading human history, entering into our story to set all things right and make all things new. Even if we know that intellectually, emotionally, it's hard to do. It's hard to get to that point where we start living it out, where we take those steps because we know that it costs us something. But at Christmas, God was able to set his God-shaped life aside and come to the life in the shape of ours. If God was able to pour himself out, empty himself, and make him nothing in humility for our sake, like, is it really that hard for us to follow in those footsteps? Is it really that impossible for us to follow in those footsteps? It's not simple. It's not an easy road to walk, but following those footsteps means following the footsteps of Jesus. And the way of Jesus is the way of hope. It's the way of healing. It's the way that we were created to walk. It's what we were created for. If God and sinner can be reconciled, who are we to withhold the offer of sinner and sinner being reconciled? The offer, not like I know how it's going to go, or I know that if I take this first step, it's all going to be perfect, it's going to be easy from here, and they're going to accept it, and everything's going to be perfect. But who am I to withhold that offer to people that I have broken relationships with if God didn't withhold it from me? It struck me as I was writing this and thinking about it this week. I think, strangely enough, one of the weirdest and saddest ways that we treat the gift of Jesus like socks and underwear at Christmas is by keeping him to ourselves and stubbornly refusing to share. Okay? Now, don't get me wrong, like, if you receive socks and undies this Christmas, when you do, like, if you're a dad, like, when you unwrap those socks, or those underwear. Keep them to yourself, okay? When it comes to that stuff you should keep to yourself. It's a good thing. Don't share those with everybody. No matter what children's books tell you, don't share your underwear. Keep them, okay? When it comes to Jesus, that's a tragedy if you do that. It's a tragedy if you do that. Like, keep your socks, keep your underwear, share your Jesus. Share your Jesus. Oh man, you guys, we miss out. We miss out on the fullness of what it means that he came. We miss out on the fullness and the excitement of the Christmas season if we just keep it to ourselves and we don't share it. Jesus came to set things and people right. And if we're willing to be vulnerable like he was vulnerable to us, if we're willing to offer reconciliation like he offered it to us, big things will happen. It won't be easy. It's going to be hard. It won't be simple. It's going to be difficult. It won't be fast. It will happen one inch at a time. One life at a time, and it will not cost us nothing because it cost him everything, but it'll change the way that we see the world. It'll change the way that we see the people around us. It'll change their lives. We will see things in relationships that we once believed were impossible come true because we began to live Christmas. And the crazy thing is, I think if we do, it'll just expand our understanding of who God is and what he's about in this world. We'll begin to see the ways that he is at work even now. Reconciling people to himself and to one another. Setting all things right and making them new. And if we do it, it'll change the way we think about Christmas. Like, Christmas for us will no longer be just this season of buying and consuming gifts. It will no longer be just a month in December where we decorate and celebrate things. Instead, we'll become a little bit more like Buddy the Elf. Christmas will become a lifestyle that we live 365. As we bring this message of a God who came to reconcile the world to himself and to one another, to our world, and as we embody it for the sake of the people around us. Let's pray.